My name is Dr. Amjad Anaizi. I'm a neurosurgeon at MedStar Georgetown University Hospital. I see a variety of patients with different neurologic disorders, ranging from brain disorders to spine disorders. I have a specific interest in cranial base and brain tumors, with a variety of pathologies such as brain tumors, vascular malformations, brain aneurysms, cerebrospinal fluid leaks, so a variety of patients. I think it's our responsibility to maximally utilize the technology that we have available to us. It's our responsibility to the patients. And so it's important that we continue to minimize the injury that the surgery causes to the patient. And so fortunately, there has been a great deal of technology and advances in technology, and our approaches have changed according to the technology that we have available to us. The thing that's most exciting is being able to address scary disorders, scary to patients and quite frankly scary to a lot of physicians, using less invasive approaches and allowing patients to recover much more quickly. That excites me, especially when patients come in with having already heard or read about the way their disorders are typically treated, and then being able to offer them something that's less invasive and seeing the relief on their face, that's probably what excites me the most. You know, you treat people the way you would want to be treated, you treat people the way you would want your mother or father, son, daughter, brother, sister treated. And so every patient, I make recommendations that I would make for my family member. I treat them like I would treat my family. And quite frankly, it, you know, often takes more than one conversation to really deliver that information and address all of the patient's questions, because it's impossible for them to absorb all the information I give them on the first visit and then have coherent questions for me. And so it's not unusual for us to see patients 2, 3, 4 times before we even operate. I think that the level of expertise here, both the training that I've had as well as my colleagues in the skull-based center, provides some of the most comprehensive cranial interventions that you will find in the country. I get up every morning and do my job because I truly feel that it's a privilege that patients allow me to take care of them with these frightening brain disorders. I enjoy doing the operation, that is my passion, and seeing patients recover from the operation post-operatively and following them post-operatively from their ICU stay to when they get home, there's nothing that gives me more satisfaction. Minimally invasive brain surgery and endoscopic brain surgery really refers to a variety of techniques that have been developed to address brain disorders while minimizing the damage that we do to both the head, the face, and the brain. The candidates for minimally invasive brain surgery continues to expand, and it really depends on the lesion, the location of that lesion, and whether it's accessible using a minimally invasive procedure. But it's surprising the number of patients that are candidates, both adults and children. I think it goes back to the point of being able to maximally utilize the technology that we have. And so we take out brain tumors through the nose without any incisions by introducing a specialized camera called an endoscope through one nostril, and then specialized instruments to reach that tumor through the other nostril. And so we use the normal passageways that you have to get to the base of the skull and are able to remove very large tumors through a very small opening. We use specialized instruments that are especially long, certainly longer than we utilize in traditional operations, and they are able to perform careful dissection. They're different from the traditional tools that we utilize for open surgery. And again, it goes back to the point of requiring specialized treatment so that you're actually accustomed to using these tools that we have at our disposal. But the endoscope, which gives you a 2D view and sometimes a 3D view of our surgical cavity and the area that we're operating on, and these special tools allow us to do a careful dissection and really utilize those same concepts of safe resection that we utilize on every brain operation, whether it's minimally invasive or traditional, but we're able to do it through the nose. minimally invasive brain procedures allow us to treat a variety of lesions in different places in the brain. When we talk about endonasal endoscopic, so specifically operations through the nose, those really refer to sinonasal malignancies as well as brain tumors that are along the base of the skull. And so those are the tumors that are best addressed with the endoscopic endonasal procedures. That's certainly a fear. Patients feel that they're going to wake up with incisions across their face or swelling or some kind of deformity. Typically, patients look exactly the same as they did preoperatively. There's no external incisions in most cases. And I think that's one important thing that the advances in endonasal endoscopic surgery have provided, is that now, in many cases, and quite frankly, most cases, we're able to avoid any transfacial incisions, any incisions across the face for resection of large sinonasal tumors. Really depends on how extensive an endonasal endoscopic procedure you have, but the recovery varies. For a standard pituitary tumor, a pituitary adenoma, patients will stay in the hospital for maybe a day or two, sometimes three, and then are able to sort of get back to their normal lifestyle within 2 to 4 weeks, and their appearance won't change. For somebody with a large sinonasal malignancy or a very large brain tumor that we take out through the nose, they often will have some packing, and that packing can stay in for a week or so before it's removed. That can sometimes create a little bit of discomfort, sort of feeling like you have to breathe through your mouth rather than through your nose, which is what most of us are accustomed to. However, there isn't a great deal of pain associated with it. You're not dealing with the pain of an incision or a craniotomy, and so there's certainly still advantages that those minimally invasive endonasal procedures offer. Endoscopic brain surgery specifically refers to the use of an endoscope, which is a specialized camera. It is a component of the minimally invasive procedures. I refer minimally invasive brain surgery, or I think of minimally invasive brain surgery as procedures that are reducing the collateral damage to the normal structures. That includes the endoscopic procedures. The endoscope is really a tool that we utilize in minimally invasive brain surgery. Minimally invasive brain procedures that do not utilize the endoscope include keyhole craniotomies. So sometimes we utilize specialized techniques where we make small incisions, small bony openings in order to minimize retraction of normal brain. And we utilize that for a variety of lesions, including brain aneurysms and brain tumors. Being able to deliver these minimally invasive brain procedures does require specialized training. So once I completed my residency in neurosurgery, I did specialized training in minimally invasive, complex brain and cranial-based surgery. And the colleagues that I work with, including my ENT colleagues, have all been fellowship trained in their respective specialties. And so it absolutely does require a great deal of training and specialization to perform these procedures safely. There are a variety of advantages that are offered by minimally invasive brain procedures. These include a faster recovery postoperatively, a decrease in potential incisions or potentially a lack of incisions, and decreased pain, quicker return to work, and hopefully a better quality of life. And quite frankly, that's what we've found, is that in most cases when we're able to deliver a minimally invasive alternative to a traditional procedure, that patient has a better quality of life postoperatively, especially in the immediate postoperative period. Comparing the recovery of minimally invasive brain procedures versus traditional brain procedures, those patients both require a postoperative stay in the hospital, sometimes shorter for the minimally invasive procedures. There is a lack of visible incisions often. We typically don't shave a patient's hair if we can avoid it. And so a patient feels like they can go back to their normal life much more quickly than somebody who has half their head shaved and has a large incision with a large craniotomy. Having said that, There are patients that still require that. The important thing about being able to deliver safe, minimally invasive procedures is recognizing when it's not appropriate to utilize. And so there are patients with certain tumors where I do not believe that a minimally invasive keyhole craniotomy or an endoscopic procedure is the best thing for that patient, and I'll tell them that. And I do get patients that specifically ask me, can you do this endoscopically? And I give them a very honest answer. I tell them either yes, absolutely, or no. It's not unusual that we prepare a patient for a more traditional procedure and we tell them, listen, we're going to do our very best to do this endoscopically or in minimally invasive fashion, but we are going to be prepared in the operating room to do this in more traditional fashion if necessary. It is very unusual that we take a patient to the operating room with the plan for a minimally invasive procedure and then transition to a traditional operation. That's extraordinarily uncommon. Minimally invasive brain procedures and endoscopic endonasal procedures are utilized to treat benign brain tumors, tumors of the cranial base, sinonasal malignancies, cancers. We treat cerebral spinal fluid leaks. We treat aneurysms, cerebral aneurysms, or arteriovenous malformations. So there's really a variety of disorders that lend themselves to treatment with minimally invasive brain operations. One of the wonderful things about being at MedStar Georgetown University Hospital is that we meet as a multidisciplinary team to discuss complex operations. And I'll tell patients that in the clinic when I first meet them. I'll tell them, listen, you have a complex case. I'm going to discuss this with my team of either the skull-based team at the skull-based meeting or the tumor board team to discuss complex brain tumors. And that really includes my ENT colleagues, my medical oncologist, radiation oncologist, neuroradiologist, neuropathologist. There's really an extensive team that's involved in those meetings. And I think it's important to be able to tell patients that, listen, I'm not making unilateral decisions, that that there is a benefit to discussing this with other subspecialists that may be able to offer you an alternative to surgery. There are often other surgeons involved in some of the minimally invasive procedures, especially the endonasal endoscopic procedures, which I perform with one of my ENT colleagues, specifically Dr. DeKlotz. So when we address pituitary tumors, pituitary adenomas, craniopharyngiomas, these are often procedures that require that we traverse the sinonasal cavity, and that's really an ENT specialty. And so I think it's important that we work as a team, and then we are in the operating room together for the entirety of the tumor resection or the repair of cerebrospinal fluid leak. You have two experienced surgeons in the OR at once taking care of you. The diagnosis of a brain tumor does not require an operation necessarily. It really depends on the type of tumor you have, the location of the tumor, and whether that tumor is really causing symptoms or not. With advances in imaging, we've really diagnosed a lot of patients with brain tumors that they never knew about. And for the number of patients I operate on, there's a much greater number of patients that I follow, and I see them every 6 months or every year, and we follow their tumors. We don't necessarily have to operate on every tumor. In fact, the majority of tumors that I see are really managed non-operatively. There are alternatives to the treatment of brain tumors. One option is surgery, but there are non-surgical options, which includes radiation to some of these brain tumors. And one great thing about MedStar Georgetown University Hospital is that we offer the CyberKnife radiosurgery as well as proton therapy. Proton therapy is a great non-surgical option for specific patients with specific types of skull-based tumors, especially in children. It's not unusual that patients come in and see me as a second opinion. They've seen one physician that has offered a more traditional operation. It's not the wrong operation, it's an alternative. And I would never, I think it's important that physicians do the operation that they feel comfortable doing. So certainly many physicians would disagree that a minimally invasive procedure is an option, because quite frankly, they don't have the experience in doing these procedures. So it's not unusual that I see a patient that's been offered a traditional operation, and then all of a sudden we say, listen, we could take this out through the nose or through a minimally invasive keyhole craniotomy. And at that point, it's confusing for the patient. They've seen one specialist that's told them they need to have it done one way, and that's the only option. If they see another specialist that tells them they should have it done a different way. So I feel for the patients. It can be very confusing. You're dealing with the diagnosis of a brain disorder. It's a stressful time in your life, and now you're seeing two specialists that are telling you two different things. So the thing that has to be understood is that these are relatively new procedures, that very few neurosurgeons have actually undergone the specialized training that's required to do these procedures. And a neurosurgeon that has not undergone that specialized training is not going to recommend a minimally invasive procedure and shouldn't, because that's not a procedure that they feel comfortable doing. But fortunately, many of us here, specifically myself and my ENT colleagues, have undergone that specialized training and feel comfortable doing these minimally invasive procedures here at MedStar Georgetown.